Good afternoon, everyone. We are happy to have you all for the program. This is Neetu Krishna. I am doing post-graduation in computer science at St. Thomas College. To say about my college, the legacy of St. Thomas College, the ancient Catholic college in Kerala, can be traced to 1989 when it was founded as an educational institution from the initiatives of Reverend Dr. Adolphus Edwin Medlicott, Monsignor John Palakaran, Mar John Manacheri, Monsignor Joseph Peta, and many like-hearted gentlemen who faded away without even disturbing the historians. Over the years, the college has built up extensive resources that can cater to the needs of more than 3,000 students from 23 departments. Our computer science department has its humble beginning to 2001 as an unaided department and has transformed itself into an aided department that creates an innovative academic environment with distinctive emphasis on the overall development of students. Research and innovations are given due importance here. Intellectual property protection is critical to fostering innovation. Without protection of ideas, business and individuals would not reap the full benefits of their inventions and would focus less on research and development. A warm welcome to the webinar on intellectual property rights, need and awareness for industry and academia, organized by Department of Computer Science in association with CPE, Institutional Innovation Council, and IQAC, St. Thomas College, Autonomous Thrissur. Every day brings us new opportunities and many blessings. Let's thank God Almighty for this opportunity. I welcome Ms. Anshi Anthony for the prayer.
Darshadishavas of blessing, this is the promise of life. There shall be seasons refreshing, sing from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessings we need. Mercy drop down as our falling, but for the showers we plead. But for the showers we plead.
Thank you, Anshi. It's my pleasure to extend a cheerful welcome to Dr. Jiju M. Matthew, head of the department, to deliver the welcome speech.
Respected Professor Dr. Sabu A., the Pro Vice Chancellor of Kannur University, His Excellency Mar Tony Nilankavil, the Auxiliary Bishop of Thrissur Archdiocese, Dr. Joy K.L., Principal St. Thomas College, Thrissur, Dr. Manju Gerard, Principal Scientist, ICAR, New Delhi, Dr. Alphonse Matthew, Vice Principal of the College and CPE Coordinator, Dr. Anil George, the IQAC Coordinator, Mrs. Ramila Ravindran, Coordinator of the webinar series, delegates from various colleges across India and the globe, my dear students and colleagues, a warm good afternoon to one and all. It is my pleasure and honor to welcome you all to the inaugural function of the webinar series on intellectual property rights, need, awareness for industry and academia. Conceptually, intellectual property rights, or IPR in short, is meant to provide incentives for inventors and innovation. The IPR system pursues two seemingly contrary objectives. First, to protect inventors from imitations and stimulate inventive activity. Second, to disseminate existing information and knowledge as a means to facilitate invention activities and innovation for the benefit of the society. Even avoiding the ethical controversy regarding the boundaries of protection of intellectual property assets, it is legitimate to raise questions regarding possible welfare and economic impacts of trade-related aspects of intellectual property on developing countries today. This seminar series is convened to provide answers to many such questions. And I wish and hope that at the end of this seminar series, you will be able to answer many such questions of your own. Mark Tony Nilankavil, our beloved manager, is a man of vision. He's been a lighthouse directing us to newer and unexplored horizons. A true scholar with a modern perspective, he is the apt person to steer our vehicle. On behalf of all gathered here virtually, I invite His Excellency to this event. Sabu sir single-handedly elevated the microbial technology research group of Kannur University to heights of glory. At research fellowship from Department of Science, Government of India in 2003. Postdoctoral research fellowship from Institute of Research and Development, France in 2007. Visiting professorship from Mexican Agency for International Cooperation and Development in 2015. Malviya Memorial Award for Senior Faculty from Biotech Research Society of India in 2017. 4 patents, 45 publications, 31 chapters, 5 books, and the list is endless. I, on behalf of all out here, welcome Sabu sir to this inaugural session. Professor Joy KL is a man of discipline. He's about to retire, but even then, with his mesmerizing energy, he amazes us as always. Thank you, sir, for all your guidance. With deep gratitude, we welcome you all to this August gathering. I have great pleasure in welcoming Dr. Manju Gerard, Principal Scientist, ICAR Headquarters, New Delhi. She is looking after the intellectual property and technology management and is extensively working on startups in agriculture. She was former faculty member of National Academy of Agriculture Research Management, Hyderabad, which is a premier institute of Indian Council for Agriculture Research. Welcome, ma'am. Sister Alfonsa, the Vice Principal and CPE Coordinator, Father Dr. Anil George, IQAC Coordinator, Vice Principals Dr. Joby Thomas and Father Dr. Martin Colombre, Deans and all faculty members, I welcome you all to this event. The overwhelming responses what we received from the very date when we publicized the details of this webinar was very heartening. As of today, we have more than 257 registrations and we are expecting few more in the days to come. On behalf of all out here in St. Thomas College, I welcome all the delegates to this webinar series. At last, but not the least, I invite all my dear students and colleagues to the inaugural ceremony. I sincerely hope you'll all enjoy today and the next 4 days of dissemination of knowledge, debate, and networking. I once again welcome all of you to this webinar. Thank you for your keen interest.
Thank you, sir. Next, I cordially invite our respected principal, Dr. Joy Kayal, to deliver the presidential address.
Hey, good afternoon to all. His Excellency Mark Tony Nilankavil, our manager, chief guest of the day, respected Vice Chancellor of Kannur University, Professor Dr. Sabu A, respected resource person, Dr. Manju Gerard, Principal Scientist, ICAR, New Delhi, Vice Principal, Dr. Joby Thomas K, Reverend Dr. Martin Kolambrath, Reverend Sister Alphonse Matthew, Dr. Jiju Matthew, the head of the Department of Computer Science, IQC Coordinator, Reverend Dr. Anil George, Professor Ramila Ravindran, Coordinator of this international webinar, faculty members, dear participants and students. It is a great that we have a 5-day international webinar in our college under the guidance of the Department of Computer Science. And I am happy to congratulate the head of the department, Dr. Jiju Matthew, the coordinator, Ms. Ramila Ravindran, and team members gratefully on behalf of the administration of this great alma mater. Intellectual property is the oil of the 21st century. The concept of intellectual property is a revolutionary idea that brought forward the importance of innovations and creativity. Unlike any other asset, intellectual property is an intangible asset that is always publicly available and can be easily imitated. Hence, it is imperative that IP is protected as much as any other asset, which is why IPR was introduced. IPRs are exclusive rights that always face a challenge of considering the interest of innovators and the society as a whole. IPRs so benefit both the creator and the user. Introduction of IPR have added intrinsic value to all kinds of creation that result in the generation of quality knowledge that is much required for the collective good of today's society. The direct and indirect impacts of innovation are overwhelming, accounting for huge economic growth and employment. IP intensive industries have seen a tremendous growth and are expected to grow rapidly in the coming decades. These industries are contributing to the economic development so much that IP of developed countries are worth much more than the nominal GDP of other countries. Strong and enforced IPR result in consumers making efficient choices and ensures that quality and authenticity of products are maintained. Adequate legal framework is necessary to protect the interest of the consumer and the innovator. As time progresses, technology advances, and the job of both creation and imitation have become so much easier. I wholeheartedly welcome and thank Professor Sabu A, Pro Vice Chancellor of Kannur University, and Dr. Manju Gerard, the Principal Scientist ICAR, for your generosity and fraternity have shown to our college. I wish every participant a very good occasion to know better, to be better equipped to keep abreast with the advancement of knowledge, especially in IPR. Wishing all of you a very fruitful academic sessions ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. With immense pleasure and honor, I invite Marthoni Neelangavil, our beloved manager and auxiliary bishop of Thrissur Archdiocese, for the inaugural address.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me? Dear, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir, audible.
Okay, then
you are audible, His Grace. You are audible.
Okay. Dear respected Professor Dr. K.L. Joy, the principal St. Thomas College Autonomous and the president of the inaugural ceremony who spoke to us just now, Professor Dr. Sabu A, Pro Vice Chancellor, Kannur University, the keynote speaker of the day, and other esteemed resource persons, Professor Dr. Alfonso Matthew, Vice Principal, Professor Dr. Jiju A. Matthew, Head of the Department Computer Science, Professor Dr. Anil Konkot, IQAC Coordinator, Ms. Ramila Ravindran, Web Series Coordinator, Ms. Neetu Krishna, dear faculty members, students, and esteemed participants. I'm very glad and indeed proud to take part in the webinar series on intellectual property, rights, need, and awareness for industry and academia, organized by the Department of Computer Science and St. Thomas College Autonomous. By looking at the resource pool, I'm quite delighted to see many eminent personalities, scholars across the globe in the list, and wish to congratulate both the webinar and the IQAC coordinators and the Department of Computer Science and the entire faculty for their efforts. In today's competitive environment, innovation is the mainstay for every educational institution and industry that leads to development of intellectual property. Identifying, developing, and leveraging innovation provides competitive wedge and aids in its long-term success. Intellectual property is not limited to technology companies, but is valuable for academic institutions, which invest nowadays huge sum in research and development for creating indigenous and ingenious products and services. To appreciate the importance of this intellectual property, it is necessary to understand the nature of different intellectual property rights, what they protect, and how the right can be obtained, and how they best be commercialized. I remember while I was in Germany visiting a home, the host got violent when he saw that I'm an Asian, because he had a bad experience of his innovation being having been copied by some Asians, and they produced products out of his property. And I think that tells us that memory of mine, in fact, takes me very much into the topic of this webinar series. Intellectual property can be seen as a bundle of property rights that protect creations of the mind. These rights can be crucial, and not only can they be used to protect our own creations, but also provide useful business tools that can be exploited commercially. Today, academia cannot survive without genuine research, and intellectual property is essential for protecting the innovations of the researchers. Different forms of intellectual property may be used to protect different aspects of your research. Not all intellectual property rights may apply to your particular field of research, but many will. And understanding not only your rights, but those of your competitors will put you on a sound commercial footing. Intellectual property rights can be approached from two sides, which is already mentioned here. On one hand, it may be seen as a negative right. That is, it can merely be used to prevent others from copying your written material or producing products that infringe upon your patents and designs. From this, you maintain a competitive edge. On the other hand, it can be used in a positive sense. Since IP is a property right, it can be bought and sold. It can be licensed so that others can use your brand name or make products that fall within your patent, for which you will receive a royalty payment. Intellectual property can be used to give you the upper hand in negotiations and can be exchanged for mutual benefit. Furthermore, intellectual property rights can be obtained globally, unleashing your business research potential to a global market. It must also be borne in mind that not only is your IP important, so is that of others. You will need to be aware of competitors' rights so that they are not infringed, which could put your own research at risk. Finally, I would like to remind you that we owe a lot to the society at large, our family, teachers, even those farmers who produce grains and other vegetables that we consume to sustain us. We owe all of them in accumulating our intellectual property. We, the individual researchers, the academia, and the industry need to be aware that we cannot properly call for our intellectual property rights without taking into consideration of the wider social web that keeps us going. I once again congratulate the department and wish and hope that this 5-day long academic extravaganza will enlighten all the delegates to provide their IP portfolio. May the Lord Almighty accompany us and guide us in this journey for the glory of his name. With the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and of Saint Thomas, the Apostle and our patron of our college. With these words, I declare the webinar series on intellectual property, rights, need, and awareness for industry and academia open. May God bless you and thank you very much.
Thank you, His Excellency. Today, we are fortunate to have with us Dr. Sabu A. Sir is currently serving as the Vice Chancellor of Kannur University. He also served as a visiting professor in multiple universities abroad. He holds 4 patents and has been honored with numerous awards and accolades for his excellence. He has around 45 research publications to his credit. On a final note, he is a fascinating individual for whose presence we are very much grateful. I feel privileged to invite Professor Dr. Sabu A., Pro Vice Chancellor of Kannur University, to deliver the keynote address.
Good evening, one and all. I hope I'm audible to everyone. Esteemed Bishop Dr. Tony Nilangavil, Principal Dr. Joy, Head of the Department of Computer Science, Dr. Jiju Matthew, other organizers of the seminar, Dr. Manju Jarad, expert in IP, representing the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, distinguished participants and dear delegates. I am so happy to share the platform of this webinar with you people to share my thoughts about protecting IPR. Esteemed Bishop was rightly telling the story of not honoring the intellectual property of others by the Asians. He was talking about his experience when he traveled across Europe. Yes, it is true, we Asians are very poor in honoring the intellectual property rights of others. When you have a patent, you celebrate it. When others have a patent, you are angry with them. You are mad at their product. This is happening everywhere. I am sitting with a laptop with the MS Office loaded into it. And if I look back and if I take a survey in my office or in my departments, I can see more than 80% of the MS Office versions are non-licensed. We don't respect the patent taken by Microsoft for their product. So if you have a patent, you celebrate. If others have the same, you don't celebrate and you don't want to celebrate. That is the culture somehow the Asians, including Indians, developed as far as IPR is concerned. And talking about IPR, here, while reading out my CV, it was told, no, I'm having some nearly 80 publications and only 4 patents. That shows our interest in protecting IPR. And when I had an opportunity to interact with some of my collaborators abroad, and we were talking about the achievements of our teamwork for a past 5-6 years, I could see that my collaborators from abroad were having more patents than publications. And from the Indian side, I could see more publications and only 1 or 2 patents coming out from the findings. And some of my collaborators from abroad, mainly from United States, who is running an industry there, a pharma company is run by him, he was telling, I'm so glad that my Indian partners, known and unknown partners, are contributing to our patents. So then we had a discussion what way our publications are helping them in innovating in product development. I am currently working in microbial technology aspects, bioprocessing, where we isolate microorganisms and we standardize media for their rapid cultivation, and we develop bioprocess the optimum conditions for production of therapeutic enzymes, industrial enzymes, sometimes bioactive substances. So we develop the bioprocess, we get the best results, sometimes we report the yield also, and we report this in some reputed journals. And one publication of this data, valid data in some reputed journal, reputed international journal. We are so proud that our papers are published in an international journal. And this vital data that we developed based on some time, 24 to 36 months of research work, we simply publish, we transfer the copyright and publish the same in international journal, and others get access to the data, the basic data they get from our publications. The details about the organism that we have isolated, the method of isolation, the method of rapid culture of that microorganism, the method of extracting the product in huge quantity, optimized levels, and the vital media components that we are adding to the bioprocess media for enhancing production. So all these data are made available to those people who are really interested in making a product out of this data. So since you are providing them with all the information, these days it is not a big job for those who are having an innovative mind to come out with a product. Since you publish everything, since they have access to all data that you have published, they can go through the data, they can come out with better ideas based on your findings, and they can formulate a product, they can go for characterization of that product, they can have a better combination of that product along with the other molecules, and they can have a preparation which will be having sometimes better industrial application, sometimes with better drug efficacy. So indirectly, my collaborator from abroad was telling, Indians, especially Indians, are contributing in a big way to the innovations abroad as far as biotech and pharma biotech sector is concerned. That is in fact very true. If you look at the publication database of different universities in Kerala, the major universities in Kerala, I can tell you, sitting in the chair of Internal Quality Assurance Cell Director, see, in Kannur University, I am holding additional charge of Internal Quality Assurance Cell Director also. So we usually review the research output from the major universities across the state. On an average, 400 to 600 research papers are published every year from the pioneering universities in the state of Kerala, whether it is from University of Kerala or Mahatma Gandhi University or Calicut University or from QSAT. That much publications are coming out every year. And most of these papers are published in reputed journals having high impact factor. But if you look at the profile of the faculty members who are patenting their invention, you will find one or two. I will say the universities which are now celebrating their 150th year of existence, the universities which are celebrating their 100th year of existence, if you look at their patent database, you will find some 10 to 15 patents only. That is, in fact, an embarrassment to people who really talk about innovations and protecting IPR. We need to change a lot. The culture of publishing everything, we need to change that. In fact, I can't blame the teacher colleagues in this regard, because if you publish in good quality, high impact journals, your promotion to the next level is guaranteed. if you don't publish, and if you're going after a patent, it may take some time, years. And to get a patent granted in India, it may take 3 to 5 years. And if you're going abroad to file a patent, it may take 1 to 1.5 years. But to publish a paper, it takes nowadays only 4 to 6 weeks. And you are enriching your biodata. Your number of publications is counted in a big way by the authorities to get you promoted to the next level. So faculty colleagues are not bothered about protecting their IPR. That is a strange situation indeed, and which need to be changed. But I will say, during the last 10-15 years, Government of Kerala and the State Higher Education Council took many initiatives to make a change in this particular scenario. With the support of the Kerala State Higher Education Council, an inter-university center for IPR studies was started in Cochin University of Science and Technology, and the Kerala State Council for Science, Technology and Environment also started a patent information center. These are all supported by Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. And these two agencies are extending their support to faculty members with an innovative mind to go for filing patents. They are facilitating. In fact, the Cochin University Center for IPR Studies is extending financial support also. They usually meet the expenses related to filing patents within the country. So these are some of the welcome initiatives taken by the Government of Kerala. And I'm happy to tell you that all of my patents were filed with the support from the Inter-University Center for IPR Studies located at CUSAT. They are extending marvelous support to academics in filing their IPR. And when you talk about, when you start blaming faculty members for not filing patents, you need to see the other side also. As I pointed out earlier, it's a time-consuming affair, and you need real talent to draft a patent, and you need to have patience. You need a lot of money to spend, especially if you are going for filing a patent abroad. To the best of my knowledge, I will tell you, you will have to spend somewhere around 4 to 9 lakh rupees if you are going for filing a patent in the United States. I'm sure you need that much money for filing a patent in the other countries, European countries also. But you have, you always have other mechanism to file a PTC and wait for your patent rights in PTC member countries also. I would like to tell you that when I was in CSIR Regional Research Lab in Trivandrum some 15 years back, I got the opportunity to file my first patent application before the patent office in Chennai. So it was only a small invention. We developed a formulation for enhanced reproduction of an industrial enzyme, a feed enzyme, phytase, from a microorganism, a fungus, Aspergillus ficus. A combination of three different salts were inducing enhanced reproduction of that particular enzyme. And since that enzyme was having a lot of commercial importance those days, we decided to go for a patent instead of publishing that in a journal. And my interest in protecting IPR by way of filing patent started those days. But once I left CSIR and after joining Kannur University, I found it very difficult to think about filing patents because the university system was not at all prepared to support the faculty members in filing patents. Now everything changed. To the best of my knowledge, I think almost all educational institutions, including all universities, adopted the National Innovation Startup Policy 2019, where you are supposed to earmark 1% of your annual budget for innovations and protection of IP. And universities and other higher education institutions are supporting the academics and students in a big way for innovations and innovation-driven entrepreneurship. So business incubation centers are being established in almost all campuses within Kerala also. Things are changing in a big way, in a rapid manner. And managements and government departments are now allocating separate funds for innovation and startups. So in this new environment of, in this new ecosystem of innovations, protecting your intellectual property is really important. I would like to remind you, when I was in CSIR, I got the opportunity to file my first patent. But those days, there was a pressure on scientists working in CSIR from the headquarters to file more patents. So if you go for filing a patent, your next year review will be okay. Something like, as directed by headquarters, people started filing more and more patents. But I would like to remind you that there is nothing interesting if you simply go for filing a patent. But if your patented invention is getting translated or if it is commercialized, then it makes sense. And let me tell you that our university departments and college departments are till now not prepared to go for commercialization of inventions from our faculty members. We have reached up to the level of making awareness among our academic community in protecting IP. And we have reached up to the level of promoting innovations, entrepreneurship. Many startup companies are now coming up from the campuses. But we need to move further, and we need to support the faculty and students in commercializing their innovations, their products, their processes. And there were a lot of challenges within our country when you talk about filing a patent, especially if you are going for filing a patent of natural origin. You need to get it approved by the National Biodiversity Authority of India. You need to sign an agreement with the National Biodiversity Authority of India regarding the access, benefit sharing, everything. And getting all these things done within the pre-designed time frame is a big challenge. So I suggest in all educational institutions, including the reputed ones like the St. Thomas College in Thrissur, you need to create a system which really supports the academics in coming out with protecting IP, going for innovation, startups, and in general, entrepreneurship. A faculty member, a teacher whose primary responsibility is teaching, guiding, and supporting students, we hardly find time to spend for these type of activities. So if all academic institutions are having a separate mechanism, like I'm sure the Innovation Council in St. Thomas College is supporting the teachers in doing all these things, but we need to have better autonomy in terms of finance. You need to have better academic autonomy so that the teachers and the students will come out with their wonderful ideas to have wonderful products, wonderful processes coming out from the college campuses. So we need to promote such innovations. I hope esteemed Bishop and manager of the college, Bishop Father Tony, will listen to all these things and support the very vibrant faculty of St. Thomas College to come out with the more innovations and entrepreneurship. In fact, when I was invited to address the gathering of this webinar, I told Dr. Jiju that I'm not an expert in IP. But I had the experience of filing IP and getting some of my patents sealed, granted by the concerned authority. But anyway, we need to think in a different way. Till now, we were talking about enriching your CV with the increasing number of publications. We need to think differently. We need not go for publication of all our results. Once you complete a research problem, once you're having sufficient data, sit back, analyze the data, and think innovatively whether you can come out with a process or a product out of the available data. if it doesn't make any sense in the way of starting something or developing something, okay, you can think about communicating your results by way of a publication to the whole world, by publishing in an international journal of repute. That makes sense. Otherwise, I'll tell you, the younger generation is very much careful about these type of things. When you talk about my generation of academics and scientists, you can always see a biodata enriched with more publications. And as I mentioned earlier, others are making use of that basic data to come out with better products. And we are happy with such publications. I'm sure the future generation will think in a different way, and they will protect their IP, and they will come out with the products and processes from the campuses, from the classrooms, and from the department laboratories. I'm not taking your time. We have esteemed experts in the field of IP, especially Dr. Manju Jaradi is here. In fact, I wanted to listen to the lecture by Dr. Manju, but I am under pressure to attend some other meetings, because, you know, sitting in the chair of a pro vice chancellor of a university, you always have some meetings for some topics of interest, or doesn't matter, you need to attend. So I hope I'll be able to get a video link of, I'm sure it is getting streamed in YouTube and all. So I'm sure I will be able to go through the recorded version of the presentations of the esteemed experts in the field. I wish all the participants an excellent session, an excellent webinar series in the area of IPAR. And I wish the Kerala academics, Kerala researchers will come out with more patents in the coming years. And I wish all the success for this webinar. And let me thank all the authorities of the college, especially Dr. Jiju, for inviting me to address the gatherings of this webinar. Thank you very much. Wish you all the very best.
Thank you, sir. Before I move to the chairman of the first session, I would like to request Sister Dr. Alphonsa Matthew, the Vice Principal of College, to say a few words to the audience on behalf of CPE, who kindly sponsored our webinar.
Your Excellency Martoni Nilankavil, Manager of the College, Dr. Joy KL, Principal, Keynote Speaker of the Day, Professor Dr. Sabu A, Pro Vice Chancellor, Kannur University, Dr. Jiju A. Matthew, Head of the Department of Computer Science, and Professor Ramila Ravindran, the Program Coordinator, and other distinguished resource persons and faculty members and my dear students. First of all, congratulations to the Department of Computer Science for organizing this 5-day long webinar series on intellectual property rights. We in a time that we need innovation in every walk of life. We need to innovate the way we teach, innovate in finding solutions to day-to-day problems, innovate in the way we think, and so on. The modern generation, or the so-called new generation, is very creative and innovative in thinking and executing more than ever before. But it is very important that our youngsters are exposed to the world of IPR to streamline the innovative initiatives. I'm sure that the 5-day long webinar series on IPR will definitely enlighten the participants to get introduced to the nuances of IPR and its documentation, and in a better way to prepare them for the future. I wish God's blessings to the successful conduct of this webinar series, and wish all the best to the organizing team. Thank you.
Thank you, sister. Next, I call up Ms. Ravila Ravindran, Assistant Professor of the Department of Computer Science, St. Thomas College, to deliver the vote of thanks.
His Excellency Martani Nilankavil, our beloved manager, Dr. Sabu A, Pro Vice Chancellor of Kannur University and our chief guest, Dr. Manju Gerard, the resource person of the day, Dr. Father Anil George K, IQAC coordinator, Dr. Sister Alfonsa Matthew, Vice Principal, Dr. Gigi Matthew, head of the department, faculty members, and dear delegates of the webinar. It is indeed my privilege to propose the vote of thanks for this occasion. I, on behalf of the Department of Computer Science, St. Thomas College, Thrissur, and on my personal behalf, extend a hearty vote of thanks to all present here. I take this opportunity to thank our principal, Dr. Joy KL, who has always inspired and supported us in all our endeavors. Our college management has always endorsed academic excellence. In spite of having a very busy schedule, His Excellency has always ensured to find time to be a part of any academic activity organized by the institution. On this occasion, I extend my thanks to His Excellency Martani Nilangavil, our manager, for all its support, benediction, and time showered upon us. We are fortunate to have with us Dr. Sabu A, Pro Vice Chancellor of Kannur University, as our chief guest. I extend my wholehearted gratitude to Sabu sir for his valuable time. Sir has highlighted the significance of filing patents and how and where we could get support for the same. He has also showed the relevance of filing a patent rather than going for publication by the faculty members. Commercialization of ideas and innovations is a demand of the day for the progress of the society and the economy. I once again extend my heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Sabu A for his valuable time and thoughts. I acknowledge our gratitude to Dr. Sister Alfonsa Matthew, the Vice Principal and CPE Coordinator, for her presence and kind funding for the webinar. I'm also grateful to Dr. Anil George Gongoth, the IQAC Coordinator, Dr. Father Martin Columbeth, Dr. Joby Thomas, the Vice Principal, Dr. Sanil Raj, the Dean of Arts, Dr. Brito Joseph, Dean of Science, for their valuable support and guidance. I, on behalf of everyone present here, on my behalf, I extend a hearty vote of thanks to the speakers of the webinar, Dr. Manju Gerard, Principal Scientist at ICAR New Delhi, Ms. Angaya Kanni, Senior Lecturer, University Technology, Mara, in Ams India, Dr. Reggie K. Joseph, Associate Professor, Institute of Studies in Industrial Development, New Delhi, is absent here. Dr. Manoj P. Samuel, Executive Director for Center for Water Resource Development and Management, Calicut, is absent here. And Dr. Lakshmi P. Shanti, Senior Manager, Scientech Patent Art Services, Private Limited, Hyderabad, is absent here, who has given their consent to be a part of the webinar for sharing their findings and views. I cannot thank everyone enough for their involvement and willingness to take the completion of tasks beyond their comfort zone. I also extend my gratitude to Mr. Justin Swaju for the technical support provided to the event. I also wish to thank my dear students who have put so much effort in the organization of the event. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the delegates across the globe who have shown keen interest in the event and is present with us right now. I'm sure this academic exercise in the upcoming 5 days will prove fruitful to you all. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Miss. With that, we come to the end of inaugural session. To start with the technical session, I invite Father Dr. Anil George K, IPSC Coordinator, to introduce our resource person, Dr. Manju Gerard, Principal Scientist, Technology Management. Audience, please do fill the feedback form that will be circulated in the comment session. Father, you are not audible.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now it's time we begin the technical session. The very first talk of this webinar series is being delivered by Dr. Manju Jarad. And I am very happy to introduce Dr. Jarad. Dr. Manju Jarad, the principal scientist, is the principal scientist at ICAR headquarters, New Delhi. She started her career as research associate at CSIR National Physical Laboratory, New Delhi, in 1997. She then joined as associate professor of chemistry at Allahabad Agricultural Institute in 2000. In 2007, Dr. Manju joined the Department of Science and Industrial Research, Ministry of Science and Technology, New Delhi, as Scientist D on deputation. She then moved to the office of the Principal Scientific Advisor in New Delhi in 2012 as Scientist E. In 2015, Dr. Manju joined back Sam Higginbottom Institute of Agriculture, Science and Technology. Dr. Manju Jarad joined National Academy of Agriculture Research Management as Principal Scientist in 2016. She has more than 20 publications to her credit and has guided 22 masters and one PhD thesis as major advisor. Dr. Manju Jarad has presented papers at various national and international forums and has experience in planning, monitoring, and coordination of science and technology research projects. Today, Dr. Manju Jarad will be talking on the topic Intellectual Property Rights, Powerhouse for Innovation and Economic Growth. Welcome, Dr. Manju Jarad. Now, the floor is all yours. Thank you.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. So thank you, Dr. Anil George, for the kind introduction. Let me first thank the organizers, especially Dr. Jiju Matthew, head of the Department of Computer Science, and Principal Dr. Joy and Bishop Martoni Nilankavil for giving me an opportunity to be a part of this international webinar on intellectual property rights, needs, and its awareness, for especially for the industry and academia. Let me say that in the inaugural session, I heard Dr. Sabu setting the stage and putting the right points that the need for IP awareness, especially in the academia, because what he said that yes, in the government institutions or research institutions like CSIR or ICAR, there are policies are well defined and the scientists go for the patent protection. But in many of the universities and the colleges, still the policies are not defined, the procedures are not in place, and the process is not there for the faculty to come up and go and protect their innovations. Yes, these are the problems and challenges. I think in the coming years, with the new national education policies, also these problems or gaps will be filled or bridged, and more and more innovations will be happening, and that will be protected in the future. So for today's lecture, I will just share my presentation. Just give me a second. Yeah, is it visible?
Not yet, ma'am. Yeah, it's come. It's come. You can make it full screen.
Okay.
It's come.
Yeah, just. Yeah, is it full screen?
It's not yet full screen.
I think it's coming. It should be
there. Yeah.
Yeah, so today I will be speaking about the flow of my presentation is because the audience is basically the students and need a lot of awareness and sensitization for students. So what I will be speaking in this 1 hour is that why the innovations are important and why it is so much of emphasis is there on innovations in the country. And like top-down approach is there from the government sector, and also how these innovations will basically lead to the economic growth. So I will be, and also I will be in between telling about the different IPs, what are the concepts of these IP, and how they are going to help in economic growth, and how they are leading for entrepreneurship development, and the students can benefit out of it. So that will be the flow of my presentation. In 107th Indian Science Congress, our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Modi ji had said that growth story of India depends on achievements in science and technology sector. So he emphasized the importance of science.
Not full screen. Can you make it full screen? The presentation is not working actually.
Sir, from my end, it is full screen.
Is it?
From my end, it is full screen. Is it full screen?
Showing as it's not yet full screen. I don't know. If you share the
sharing full screen from my end.
Is it? But it is showing in the on the left pan. The slides are being shown on the right. The current slide is being shown.
I think somebody has to help me out, because I'm making in slideshow mode, and it is in full screen from my side. Like.
Close the share option, then again share as the whole screen. Share the whole screen instead of PPT. Use share the whole screen. Maybe.
Just a moment. I'll unshare and then share.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. I have to go to the application window and then share. Is it coming?
Yeah, it's coming. But it's still not yet. Have you given the slideshow?
Yes. Now I have given.
Anyway, it's showing not in slideshow mode. It is showing not in presentation mode. It is showing the slides, but not in slideshow mode. Anyway, ma'am, I mean, you may go ahead. It's okay.
Father, I think from my side, I'm putting it on the... Full screen mode only, slideshow mode only. I don't know why it is coming there like that.
Anyway,
I think so. Okay, explaining that even the
ma'am, excuse me, ma'am. Can you first keep the slideshow on, and after that you can share the screen. Then it will come properly. First, you have to keep it for.
You know, but then I am not able to. Just a moment. Just give me a second.
Ma'am, they can use Control and D to change the tab.
Yeah, I have put on slideshow. So, but then I have to. Yeah, and now I am. Okay, now I am sharing.
First slide, share, and after that.
Sorry? Yeah, I'm sharing the screen. Sure. So here. Okay, now I'm sharing the screen. So here it's coming entire screen, application window, and Chrome tab. So I'm putting on application window.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it the way? And then my, so when I'm putting application window, and then I am sharing.
Yes.
Yeah, is it there?
Yeah, it's coming, ma'am. Just a second. No, still the other thing. Your screen, full screen is coming.
Ma'am, probably you can give it as entire screen. Entire screen. That will work okay. When you play a full screen, yeah. When you give the slideshow, if you give the entire screen, it will might work.
Sir, I am just putting it on slideshow mode only. It is there on the slideshow mode. And
you may stop share and again give share and give entire screen option.
Just a moment. Okay. Yeah. Now I am sharing and then share screen and
entire screen.
You know, entire screen. You know, but when I am putting entire screen, my presentation is not there. I can't see my presentation.
No, after that you can take your PPT and start sharing. Start doing the slideshow.
Just okay.
Yeah.
When I am putting entire screen, actually that share button is not moving and it doesn't open up. When I am putting entire screen, that I am not able to click that share button.
Is it?
It only comes when I am putting my application window.
You know, when you take the your entire screen, you click on that rectangle area, then it will be chosen.
Okay. Just
click on that rectangle area. Now you give slideshow.
No, but I can't see my slide here. That is what. I'm sorry.
Okay. Just open the PowerPoint. Okay, now you give slideshow. Fine, that's fine. Done.
Okay. It's done. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Sorry for the technical hit that has happened.
It's okay.
So the motto, what the Prime Minister has said, that the young generation or the young scientists should innovate, patent, produce, and prosper. So that has to be the motto for the coming generations with the help of science and technology. So if you look at the science and technology system in India, we have quite a good number of scientific departments. We have the government ministries are there, and we have around 12 major scientific ministries are there, and some 400 to 500 national labs are there, more than 1500 R&D units in the industries there, MNC R&D facilities, as well as all the universities and colleges. So all these become the part of the S&T power, and India is doing pretty good, especially in many of the areas. Is doing pretty well in the innovation and as the creativity. So when we look at innovation, what is innovation and why so much of focus is there of the government in innovation? You know that the India's demographics, India is a young nation because more than 50% of our youth are the population is below 35 years, and the youth is more creative. And So government is looking to channelize this creativity or the innovation coming from the youth to in a better way, so that it can be utilized to create things, to create new products, to manufacture new things, and so that India becomes strong in taking up a leading position. And there is also moving from the agriculture-based society towards the knowledge-based society. So basically, when we look at the world economy, there's a paradigm shift which is happening. As I told you, we are moving from agriculture economy to industrial economy, where we had the importance of machinery, the management and capital. But in the present era, when we look the knowledge economy, the innovation is the most important thing, and which is supported by the S&T as well as the intellectual property rights. So that is why the IPR takes up an important position in the knowledge economy. When we look at innovation, what is innovation? Innovation, if you look at the textbook definition of innovation, it is said that implementation of a new and significantly improved product or a service or a process or a marketing method or a new organization method. Now, innovation can happen not only in products, because we can see every now and then a new product coming from the industry. So yes, that is innovation. But when you look at service, now the Uber and Ola has become a normal norm for us. It is not that earlier taxi services were not there, but Uber and Ola has brought up a new service innovation in that sector. Similarly, any new process. Now the generics in the pharmaceutical industry, that has come up with the innovation, because they have come up with the new process innovation, and that has really helped India to secure a strong position in the pharmaceuticals. Or a new marketing method. All the e-commerce methods, they are all new marketing methods. It was not that marketing was not happened earlier, but with the digital payments or the Paytm or the Flipkart or the Zomato, all these are the new marketing and the organized. So these are the new innovation that are happening all around us. And it is said that innovation is basically, when you look at innovation, it is a kind of a funnel shape. It has to be there, where there is requirement of more than 3,000 raw ideas has to come. And out of these 3,000 raw ideas, the successful launch product will be only one. That means these raw ideas has to be formulated as ideas, the submitted ideas, then into projects, then developments and launches. And finally, from 3,000 raw ideas, only one successful product will be launched in the market. So that is the reason so much of emphasis is there on innovation, that more and more innovation has to come from the society, from the youth, from the students, so that out of these raw ideas which are coming up, at least one will be successful. So more and more successful products will be there in the market. And basically, these are the things which will make the India as more self-reliant or Atmanirbhar. And also, when we are able to protect these innovations which are coming from the society, if we are able to protect it, that is going to be benefit the country. When we look at the innovation process, it starts with the recognition of the idea, the concept development, the prototype development, and also we have to look how it is going to work in the market. We have to have a good market research, market understanding of that product. And then we have to remove the problems that are coming. We have to debug the problems. We have to ramp up the facilities. And then finally the launch happens. So it is a long process. It's not just happens in a few months or a year. It may take many years for finally a idea to be finally converted into a launch in the market. When we look at the innovation ecosystem, we all are part of that ecosystem. Like we have the academia, which are the colleges and the universities. We have the public sector. We have the CSIR Institute or the ICR Institute, DRDO Institutes, or the government research institutes are there. Of course, private industry is there. And the new phenomena, that is the startups. And every sector, they have their own type of fundings on which, based on which, they will be working and bringing out the innovations in the science and technology sector. But again, one has to remember that all these innovation that is happening in the country, it has to be in the ambit of policy environment, business environment, and regulatory environment. It is important that when you do your research, it is important that you have to look what is the policy of the country, what is the policy, what is the business environment in our country. If everything is in sync, then only that innovation will be taken forward and it will be successful in market. Otherwise, many of the innovation that happens comes up, it goes up the prototype level, but then it dies down. It never reaches to the market. So it becomes important to have an idea when the when the innovations happens in the academy sector, it is important to see what is the policy and the regulatory environment. I'll just give you an example here. One of the agriculture universities in Bangalore, they were working on BT Brinjal. And BT Brinjal, because being from ICR, I think my example, some of the examples I will be quoting from agriculture sector. So they came out with the technology for the BT Brinjal, which was very successful. But unfortunately, India is still not ready for the BT, except for BT cotton. So we don't have the regulatory procedures. We don't have that policy environment. So that particular technology is still in the shelf. It has not seen the light of the market. So that is what I'm saying, that when you come out with these innovations, it is important to see all these policy as well as regulatory environment within the country. Just to give a glimpse of the most innovative universities of 2019, we can see, of course, all these are Stanford or US universities or MIT or Harvard. Some of our Indian universities are there, but it is in the not most 500, maybe within 500 list is there, like some of the IITs as well as Indian Institute of Science or Delhi University is there. But unfortunately, we have so many universities and colleges in the country, but they are not able to make up to the ranking of the innovative university in across the globe. So why I wanted to show this, that because many of the innovations that basically that originates from the university research. In fact, the university is the powerhouse of these innovations. So many of the innovations that basically came out from the research that is happening at the university level, then they come to the market, they get commercialized, and then they become part of the society. Just to give an example, like the seat belt, we all travel by air so frequently. The seat belt, which was basically it came out from Cornell University as an innovation from the university, it was taken up, commercialized, and now it is there for the whole society to use it. So many other examples. These are just few examples are there, but so many other examples are there which have come out from the university or the college research that is happening in the academia. These are some of the most innovative companies. You know, we all aspire for the Apple products. What is so different in Apple products? That is the why it has become one of the most innovative companies, because the products which the Apple brings out, they are a kind of a way ahead than the others. So they are so innovative, very new kind of a technology they basically work on. So that is the reason they have that top position, they hold that top position in the rankings of the innovative organizations. Now, just to again give you some idea about that how this ranking of takes place about the innovations, there is a Global Innovation Index that is done by World Intellectual Property Organization at Geneva. And basically they come out with these kind of a ranking where they rank the countries across the globe. And if you see the ranking of India, it has jumped from 81th rank to 48th rank in last 6 years. So last year in 2020, India ranked at 48. And when they do this kind of a ranking about seeing the innovations across the country, they have different indicators. Now, they look at the institution, the capital, human capital, the infrastructure, the business sophistication, the knowledge and technology outputs, creative outputs. So these are the some of the sub indicators which the ranking method, they use it for ranking method, and accordingly the countries are ranked. And I'm happy to share that the India was ranked at 27 in the knowledge and technology outputs. So there are many indicators at which India is doing far, far better. But of course, there are many other indicators where India has to improve. As a nation, we have to improve so that we can scale in the Global Innovation Index. The last year, the best ranking or the first ranking was Switzerland, and after that, Sweden and US. So these are the most innovative countries. And when you look at the infrastructure, when you look at the products they are bringing out, when they look at the S&T infrastructure they are having or the manpower they are having, we can see they have a difference. So there is a difference. So that is what in India, we have to move ahead in maybe reaching those scale. This slide will give you a kind of a indicate that there is a kind of a interlinkage of science, technology, and innovation, and all three are interlinked, and they basically work towards national prosperity. So when you look at science is basically scholarship driven, where it happens in academia with we create the advanced knowledge with the help of students or faculty, and out of that few things have certain value. There is a value of this knowledge which is taken by the industry and then convert into technology. And industry or technology is market driven. So as the market drives this technology, the industry is set up, they come out, they create jobs, and then what happens? It leads to competition. And then that innovation, the countries or the organization will take up the leadership position, which are more innovative, because innovation is the thing which will lead to competitiveness, which will, and the business or the organization which are more innovative, they have an edge over others. So ultimately all this is basically leading to the nation's prosperity. This is just to show that how they the trajectory of innovation and R&D is there in India, because from 1970 we have moved far ahead, and we are in a much, much better position, especially after 1990 when the liberalization happened, and there was a growth era after 2005, and where we have set up the National Innovation Council, we have adopted the Science and Technology Innovation Policy in 2013, and so many other policies we have made up in the country, so that the innovation and R&D is supported in the country. But innovation in India, as by Dr. R. A. Mashelkar, who was the former DG of CSIR, he said that India basically needs a Gandhian innovation, where he has said it that India needs more innovation for less money for more people. So that is the innovation which is India, or our students or our young generation should look for, because we need more innovation. We are a large country, we need more innovation, but of course we have less money. So whatever innovation we are making, it has to be for a less money, and for which can be utilized by more people. And let me tell you the best example of this innovation. If you look at the Mars mission, Mars mission is 1/100 of what the US or the other countries has made. But India has come out with this mission because it has made more innovation with less money. But the innovation is will be utilized for many. It's a large country. Many people will be benefited out of it. So even the students or the faculty, when we look at innovation, maybe this thing we should keep it in mind that in India we should look for this Gandhian innovation. Coming to the intellectual property, we need to protect our innovation. And how we can protect our innovation or how we can protect our intellectual property? Now come, there is a legal procedure. These are the legal rights. So basically, intellectual property is nothing but your creation of mind. The ideas which are created in your mind, they have to be protected, but they can't be protected unless it is in a tangible or a written form. So when you convert the ideas of your mind into a tangible or a written form, there are legal rights by which you can protect it in the industrial or art, literary or artistic field. So these are what are known as intellectual property rights. And why do you need that IP protection? Of course, you need the IP protection because it is going to benefit the economy of the country. It promotes the innovation. It will help the business to monetize their innovation, to take money, to make money out of it, to grow. And also in India, it will help the SMEs because small and medium enterprises are there which need a lot of innovation. So when you protect their IP coming out of from these organizations, they will benefit more out of it. They will be at a better negotiation power and they can grow better. And ultimately, these innovations will benefit the consumer and the society. Just for the information of the students, 26th April is the World Intellectual Property Day. And this year's theme is IP and SMEs, taking your ideas to market. So basically, WIPO, or the World Intellectual Property Organization, was established in 1967 under UN, and it promotes the IP throughout the world and headquartered in Geneva. This is the national IPR policy, because looking at the importance of IP and giving a more kind of a awareness and support in the country, Government of India came out with the National IPR Policy in May 2016 with a slogan of Creative India and Innovative India. It has seven different components, including the IPR awareness, and generation of IP, its commercialization, legal right, enforcement, all these are part of the IP policy that is there, which India has brought out in 2016. Now, coming to the IP, it is a kind of a bundle of rights. So there's a big basket. We have many IPs, different IPs are there. So these IPs are patents, industrial designs, geographical indications, integrated circuits, copyrights, trade secrets, plant protection variety, trademarks, utility patents. Of course, utility patents is not valid in India, but they are valid in US and America. So these are the 6 to 7 IPs by which you under the TRIPS trade related and industrial property rights, you can protect your innovation through various IPs. I think I'll just go through one by one. So coming to the patents, which is the most important and very effective means of protection of your IP. So basically it's a statutory right granted by the government for an invention for a limited period of time, because you can have a patent on a technology or a process or a product only for 20 years. So you can have that benefit of for maximum 20 years only if you submit all the fees and all to the government. And after 20 years, it becomes open to the public. So basically, but then before that, you have to disclose the invention. The applicant has to disclose the invention. So you have to get your patent in the public domain. So basically the patent is a kind of exclusive right that is given to a person or to prevent a third party from making, using, selling, offering or importing the products or a process within the country. Of course, India is now giving the patent for product as well as process. Earlier, it was only for products. So patents, again, it is territorial in nature. There is no global patent. So if you want to patent your technology or any idea, whatever it is, then you have to first patent it in India. And if you want to patent in US or China, then you have to patent it separately for that country. Otherwise, any other person can use that patent and use it, and you have no right over that. So, but then if you want to patent in multiple countries, you can use the PCT route also. What is the means that how you can see that a idea or a technology is patented? Only thing, it has to, these three eligible conditions has to be seen. That one thing is that the technology or the product has to be new or novel. It has to be useful or it has to be inventive. It has to be, it should be non-obvious. It should not be obvious to any person of that knowledgeable area in that area. And also it has to be pertained to a patentable subject matter. So if anything fulfills these three conditions, that particular technology or a product is eligible for getting a patent. There is no age bar for a patent holder. Just for information, this is a, Hrideshwar, this is a small boy, a nine-year-old boy. He got a patent design for his, he came out with a six-player circular chess and he has a patent design in his name. So there is no kind of a age bar for your patenting. Students can come forward if they have an idea, they can go ahead and patent. And of course, but then it has to be through proper channel, through your institution, wherever you are, you are as a student. So all that channel has to be for, going through the channel, you have to go through. Now, just again, how a idea, when you start with the idea, and then you reach to a product. Now, if you look back in the mythology, if you know that in Ramayana, when the Lakshman was hit by an arrow, so Hanuman, Ram had said Hanuman to go to the and get some the herb. So he brought the whole mountain or the whole hill, and from that, that Sanjeevani was taken and it was given. It was a pharmaceutical component was there and it was a herb. It was given to Lakshman. Okay. So, but again, it was, there was no kind of a patent on it. It was not known. And Hanuman brought the whole hill. But if you look at 20 years back in Kerala itself, there's a product called Jeevani. Now, which was from a herb that is Arogya Pacha, this is Trichophus. So this shrub, basically, there was a scientist of CSIR or Pushpangadan. He and his team was basically walking in the Western Ghats. And while they were walking and climbing the hill, he observed that some of the tribes were also with them. So he observed that these tribal people are eating some leaves or the barks of the tree and they are not at all tired. So he observed it and then he asked the tribe about this. And then he basically did a lot of research. He brought out the formulations and basically came out with this herbal product that is called Jeevani, which is anti-stress, or basically it gives a boost to your immunity, and basically it relieves the stress, it relieves the fatigue, and they also protected their but I think they have not gone for a patent protection to it, but basically they did the benefit sharing. They have whatever money they got from it, a part of it as a royalty, it is going to the tribal population to help the tribes. And if you look at today, or now, when we are going through the pandemic time, There was a lot of hue and cry because of the COVID-19. There is no medicine available, no vaccine available. But within a year, so many vaccine has come out. And in India itself, we have the Covaxin and as well as the Covishield. Two vaccines are available. Now, Covaxin, for example, it is completely indigenous vaccine, which is brought out by Bharat Biotech. And I'm sure it is a lot of patent is there. It is all these formulation and many things, it is all patented. But then that is because to protect the innovations of that vaccine. But that doesn't stop you that you can give it to the other country for free also. That once you protect, you can always give it free those who want. But that is the policy which you can have. But in case if you're not protecting your innovation, there is always a chance that somebody else can copy it and use accordingly, and you will lose the benefit out of it. So because today India has a vaccine, it is patent protected, the company Bharat Biotech can globally sell and make money or make profit, and their company can grow. But if they don't protect it, anyone can copy, and when they come out with their products and sell it in their own different countries, Bharat Biotech cannot go for a legally to the court that there is an infringement on the innovation. So that is the reason that it becomes important, that protection of IP becomes important. When we look at the world ranking of IP protection, Dr. Sabu was mentioning that our academia is good in coming out with publication, with quality publication. But when we look at the patent numbers, the numbers are very less. That's true. If you look at the total patent application worldwide, in 2019 alone, it is 3.2 million patents were filed. And out of that, 1.5 million patents were granted in 2019 itself. And if you look at India, our total filing application in 2019 is about 50,000. And out of these 50,000 application in the countrywide, only 15,000 has been granted. So that are the numbers. The numbers can speak for themselves. India has to do far, far better in patent filing as well as granting of the patent application. And if you look at the different states which are filing aggressively, I would say Maharashtra has come out with more than 4,000 patents in 2019. Kerala is having only 272 patents. So this is kind of, I have got this data from the Indian Patent Office. So the states like Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, these are the states which are patenting. They are more aware or more aggressively patenting their innovations in the country. Some of the top applicants in the patent filings, when you look at the institutes or the universities, the IITs are the top filing organization or the institutes in our country, followed by Chandigarh University, and some of the private universities are coming forward. See, Amity, SRM Institute, all these are the private universities, and they have they are coming in a big way in patenting their innovation. And looking at some of the government organization or the science and technology organization, CSIR is the foremost organization which is patenting, and followed by DRDO or Indian Institute of Science or ICR. And in fact, in Kerala, Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute of Medical Sciences and Technology, because it's again, a lot of technology comes out with this organization, and they are filing extensively. Now coming to the other IP, that is the trademarks or the trade secret. Trademarks is nothing but which is a brand or a logo or a tagline, which has to be distinctive, but not deceptive. So trademark is basically which will identify with that any organization. Or for example, when you look at the big M, from I think a four-year-old child also understand that this is for McDonald's. Or you can easily see Apple with this mark, you know that it is for electronic goods. It is not for fruit or the Google. So all this is creating a brand value for the goods. So trademark is something which creates a brand value for the organization. And why it is important? Yes, it is important because especially when the mergers and acquisition happens within the business communities or the business organization, these are the intangible assets that will be valued. Their valuation will help in having some, when they have to transfer the amount, that how much brand value or how much worth is that company is for. Similarly, the trade secret. Now, trade secret is something like undisclosed information or a secret, which is guarded very carefully. For example, Coca-Cola. Nobody knows the formulation of Coca-Cola, and their whole business model is based on this trade secret only. Only thing, if trade secret, if somebody is able to hack it or find out about this formulation, then they, of course, they cannot go to the court because they have not gone legally protected it as such. So, but their business model, they keep it so carefully guarded that nobody has access to it, and their business, Coca-Cola is a multi-billion dollar business, and their business runs on it only. The other type of IP is copyrights. Now, copyrights is a very old IP. In fact, in India, the Copyright Act was in 1957 itself, while the Patent Act was in 1970. So, in 1957 itself, we had the Copyright Act, and it is basically copyright is for the original representation of the idea or the original expression of ideas. So, it happens in literally or films, musicals, dramatics, artistics, or sound recordings. And we have the economic rights as well as the moral rights of copyrights. Now, for example, Chetan Bhagat's books you must have read. This too. So, when a film is made out of the book, so Chetan Bhagat basically has the kind of a copyright on his book, and he is giving his copyright, or he is giving his copyright to the producer of the film to make that film. So whatever business happened between them, based on that he will get the royalty. So that is how it happens. So he is the original author of that book, and he can give his economic rights to the producer of the film, or maybe making a drama out of it, or making a musical out of it, of that whatever he has book he has created, or the poem he has created. He can give that rights, and if he wants, he can stop them also. So there was again an interesting case of famous music composer Ilaiyaraja and the singer Balasubramaniam. Balasubramaniam basically had announced on Facebook that he was singing these songs composed by Ilaiyaraja in across the globe. And basically, Ilaiyaraja had filed a suit against Balasubramaniam that he has not taken the copyright because he was the original composer of that song. And if Balasubramaniam want to sing that song to audience at the global level, and it's a commercial aspect, in that case he has to get the royalty. So these are the finer aspects of that, so that ultimately copyright basically benefits the original writer or the author who is creating that particular either it can be a book, or it can be a drama, it can be a poem or any music. So that is how, and this is valid for till the death of the person, and plus 60 years. So 60 years after the death of the creator. So that is how the copyrights are valid. And for example, Gitanjali, which was written by Rabindranath Tagore, and their children, Rabindranath Tagore's children, are still getting the benefit of the royalty by the sale of the Gitanjali book. So that is how, after 60 years, they can avail that, and then of course, then it becomes redundant and it becomes open to the public. Even Mother Teresa's this sari of Sisters of Charity, this blue border sari with a thick blue border and two thin blue border. So this sari has also been copyrighted by Sisters of Charity. So in future, if someone wants to use it for commercial purpose, not for charity or other things, but or personal use, but for commercial purpose, if somebody wants to use it, they have to take the permissions from Sisters of Charity. So under that copyright, even the sari is protected and the people cannot use it for commercial purpose. Another type of IP is the industrial design. There are so many industrial designs. Basically, it has to be new and original. So basically, it demands that it has to be ornamental or aesthetic. Doesn't matter. It is what is the material doesn't matter. Like in patterns, even the material of that product will matter. But in the industrial design, it is only that it has to be some what is the appearance of that object. If it's a new and original idea, then you can go for a registration of that particular industrial design. So many cars or watches or jewelry, all these are protected under industrial design. And the businesses, like any new design, they will definitely go and protect their design across the world. Another type of IP which is more helpful to the society, that is the geographical indications. Now, GI tag is basically the mark or the collective mark given to a cooperative or producers. And this is only thing that the mark denotes the product has to be of a certain geographical origin with a certain quality and standards. For example, in Kerala, we have Arimulla Kannadi. So basically, it is a kind of a unique product which is made by a certain people of that community. So the tag is, GI tag is given to that community. They are the ones who can produce this and the producers will get a higher price because of the GI tag. And someone else who is not a part of the producer, they have to basically take that license from them to sell it. But they can, if they want to put that GI tag on that as a Arimulla Kannadi, or other products are like, there is blue pottery of Jaipur or cashew fenny. Lot of agriculture products are also there under GI tag. And lot of handicrafts are there, which is basically limited to a certain origin. For example, Banarsi Sari. Now, Banarsi Sari is famous because it is weaved by the weavers of the Banaras. So it is basically given, the tag is given to the Banarsi Sari, or Madhubani paintings from Bihar, or even a horticulture product like Madurai Malli. It is Madurai, it's a horticulture product, a flower, which has certain qualities and certain area of Tamil Nadu or Madurai, the malli coming out, this flower coming out this area, they have certain kind of a special characteristics which was identified, and those farmers or those growers have this GI tag and they can use it for their business. So that is how basically geographical indications help the growers. And GI are not given to individual, but they are given to the group of people or the group of producers. Now, these are some of the GI tags of given to Kerala, like the coir, and then some cardamom is there, Malabar black pepper is there, then jaggery of certain areas, or even Navara rice or Matta rice. All these products have got the GI tag, and using their GI tag, they will indicate a certain quality, and the farmers or the people or handicrafts who are making these handicrafts, they get benefit out of it. The next type of the IP, which is the Plant Protection Variety and Farmers Act, PPVFRA. This is basically for the protection of the plants, variety, and also it helps the rights of the farmers as well as the plant breeders. So in India, we cannot patent the plants, or but we can go for a PPV, a plant protection variety under PPV FRA Act. This act was came in 2000. And under this act, it's basically sui generis act. It is equivalent to what it is there in other countries, in US and other countries. So basically this act is to protect the new varieties, the new crop varieties that are coming, or like in ICR, brings out so many new varieties as every year, even for crops or the horticulture crops or banana or so many other plants, even fruits and vegetables. So all these new varieties can be protected under PPV FRA. And there are many old varieties, or farmers also, they do the farming and bring out their own varieties. So they can also be protected under PPV FRA. And also these transgenics, like if, as I told you, BT Brinjal or any other BT transgenic variety, which is a research institute is bringing out, they can also, or hybrids, all these can be protected under plant protection variety and farmers act. So, and also it is not that you can use a IP only one in a product, only one IP. You can use multiple IP for protecting a product. I'll just give you an example. Like, for example, somebody has come out with a health drink technology. Now, this health drink technology can be protected by multiple IPs. Like, you can have a trademark. You can have a trademark for the soft drink which you are making out of that health drinks. So that once you have a trademark, you can sell it to consumers. You will come out with a logo or things like that. So it will be popular. It will become a brand. You can have a copyright on the advertisement material which you are using for promotion of the soft drink. So that can be, that whatever the way it is written, the slogan it is made, all that can be copyrighted. Then you can have a trade secret. For example, if you have a certain formulation of that soft drink, of that concentrate, or some marketing techniques, so all this can be put under trade secret. Or you can have a GI. For example, if it is of a certain region, like as I told you, Feni is from Goa. So if this particular health drink is coming out from a certain region of Kerala, let's say, so you can even go for a GI. Or you can, if you have come out with a new variety of a plant, and from that you are making a health drink, so you can also protect that particular plant variety under PPV FRA Act. So there are different ways in which you can go for a protection of using the different IPs for a single product, for a single product. Now coming to some of the economic benefit or impact that will have because of the protection of the IPs. From ICR, I'm just taking this example, just one example. This Pusa Basmati 1121, this was a variety of Pusa that was has made from Indian Agriculture Research Institute, IAR, in New Delhi. And this particular Pusa Basmati rice, it is very popular, and it becomes around 2 centimeters after cooking. And the export earnings is about 19,000 crore just for 1 year, 2018. So you know that Basmati rice is very popular in India and abroad also. So in this is the export earnings of only one variety of rice, that is Pusa Basmati, and you are getting export earnings of almost 20,000 crore. So this is the economic impact if you protect your IP you can have. So for example, if St. Thomas College comes out with a product and it is commercialized, and it has commercialized in a big way, so the institute will be getting the royalty, and this royalty will be there for many years, almost like if it is a patented, you will get 20 years royalty. And so if when you license to different people, so that is the benefit or economic impact you will have. Another example of like sugarcane, this is also again from the agriculture. So now this particular sugarcane is grown in 82% in Uttar Pradesh, and it is again very dominant in other the states like Punjab, Haryana, and more than 7,000 crores of money is made from sugar and the byproducts every year from only one variety of the sugarcane. So that is the economic impact. So the research institute, the academic institute, which who are working, they have a great potential. Only thing, it has to be protected at the right time. Like if you don't protect, you lose. Because once you publish, before protecting your IP, then you cannot protect. Because it is already in the public domain, you cannot protect it. So it is, as Dr. Sabu was also saying, it is important that you protect your innovations first and then go for publication, because you never know, the commercialization happens maybe after 5 years or 8 years, but once the commercialization happens and if your product is a success, then you get the benefit out of it. Then coming to the commercialization, how it is benefiting, how the protection of the IP is benefiting, because today startups are a buzzword. Now, what is happening, the innovations which are coming up in the from the institutions or the organizations or universities, they are taken up by many startups and they take it forward and take it for commercialization. That is one way. Other way is that the startup is having their own technology. So, but they are not able to scale. They need a lot of hand-holding. So for that, incubation is there. So there is a lot of incubators that are mushrooming in all the research institute as well as the universities. So these startups with innovative ideas can come to these incubation centers. They can get all the kind of a hand-holding and support, technical support, as well as the business support and the IP support, and they can grow fast. I'll just give you two examples. These two startups, they are based on artificial intelligence, IoT, and sensor technology. Here we have this Mr. Taranjit Singh. He is basically, he was a, he was in IT sector. He left his job and then he has taken up this startup, and he has come up with the imaging technologies which can even measure the moisture of the tea leaves and of helping the agriculture sector. So now this particular startup has grown in last 3-4 years, got a lot of funding and doing extremely well. Now another startup of Poultrymon, this husband and wife couple, they have made an IoT sensor for the hatcheries. So they are basically giving a solution of complete automation of hatcheries. And lot of demand is there for these kind of startups. Another, as I was telling, these are the two technologies is basically at ICIFT, Central Institute of Fisheries Technology in Cochin. And this technology was taken by these two women, and they have started their own companies. They have come out and they are doing pretty well. And so this is the other way. So in fact, because a lot of incubation centers have come in a lot of universities and academic institutions, both these kind of a system can work, and the institutions can take forward their innovation through these startups and lead for commercialization. And ultimately, since the innovations are patent protected, the benefit will come to the university as well as the academic institution. So I think I would like to conclude with this. I know I've already overshooted my time. So I just want to conclude that innovation is important to inspire the creativity and knowledge economy, and the protection of IP or awareness of IP will help, and they boost the innovation, and these innovation can lead to many enterprises, many startups, and it can support the entrepreneurship, so that these entrepreneurs or startups can take the technology to the market, and ultimately the country is going to benefit. I would like to stop with the quoting our Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, especially for the students, the young people who are watching this, that you have to dream. You have to dream before your dreams can come true. So I urge all the students to dream big so that your dreams can come true and you can come out with your ideas and later on come out with the technologies that can be protected and you can bring laurels to your institution and in the process you will also grow. So thank you very much. So I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. So over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Manju Jarar. It was an excellent exposition on intellectual property rights. In fact, during the last few years, we have had several sessions on IPR in our college, but I think this session stands out. Thank you so much for your wonderful exposition through illustrations, through examples, through anecdotes, through experiences that you have had in your personal professional life. You have rightly given us the ideas as to how to go about it. I think colleges like ours, we have excellent faculty members. And also, as Dr. Sabu mentioned rightly, most of our works, you know, go unnoticed and sometimes go without getting enough credentials for the kind of quality work that has been done. That is because of the ignorance or kind of, you know, fear to go for patents, many a time I feel. I would like to ask you this question, like how to create that kind of confidence among the researchers, like teachers who are doing research, to go for patents for the work that they do? How can we create that among the faculty members?
I think one thing you are already doing, it is awareness. But along with awareness, you need the procedures and policy. See, when patents, when you go for patents, it's it is not for free. A lot of money aspect is there. And because when the faculty is going for patenting, he is working for the college. So basically the patent will be in the name of the college. It will not, the faculty will be only the owner, owner will be the college. He will be the innovator. He will be the innovator. So I think first that you should formulate a policy. A policy should be there and in which all rules and regulations will be there. Even if somebody goes to patent, who is going to file the money? It has to be filed from the university or the college. The individual will not put a money. So you have to allocate some money for that. And also, like if that goes further, it get commercialized, how much percentage of the royalty the innovator is going to get? How much percentage it will go to the college? How much percentage it will be distributed? So all these procedures should be there. So what I suggest that there should be an intellectual property cell which will take forward all these things. And there has to be an IP agent also. Maybe you can hire an on case-to-case basis also, because drafting a patent is not easy. Maybe a faculty cannot, will be a lot of things, technical details are there or legal things are there. He or she may not be able to do it. So you need the IP agent or a legal person to take it forward. So first more thing, I think first important point is to put the policy and the procedures at place in your college. And then you move ahead with that. I think that will give a lot of confidence. It will be more transparent that, okay, these are the rules. The faculty will also understand and accordingly they will do it.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Another question that I would like to put, like, you know, sometimes, you know, the faculty or the researcher who does this work doesn't get that confidence that this is good enough to go for patent. But at the same time, when we come across some of the patent works by some other researchers, okay, then we realize that, okay, I could have gone for this. This was good enough to go for patent. So that is badly missing. I mean, the researchers, they don't get that confidence to go for or not. for this patent. So how that can be addressed?
That is very true, because at times when you were doing research, we underestimate ourselves also. We don't know whether. So maybe you can take a legal help, just to understand illegal from help, and you should have a non-disclosure agreement with the legal person so that none of the things will be disclosed, and discuss with the IP agent. So the person will give you more guidance about it, how to go about whether it is worth patenting or not. And even if it is not there, I can suggest that if you think it is a very innovative idea and it can be patented, maybe you can go for a provisional patent. At least someone else will not be able to patent it. You go for a provisional patent, and if you are not able to take it through, it will get abandoned. But you, at least you will have in your name, someone else will not be able to patent it.
Okay, yes. Yeah, make sure that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. I think if somebody else has got any questions, they can put forward. Otherwise, on the chat box, I was going through this chat box. There has been very good comments about the talk. Thank you, ma'am. It has been a wonderful session. There was very good comments on the YouTube channel on the talk. So that's very good. But no questions have come. So let us conclude this session. So thank you once again. I think this session has given us more confidence to go for proper IPR procedures when we do some work. And this is an area that is badly missing among the researchers and the teachers in Kerala and also in India. If you take, I saw the patent statistics in 2018, the number of patents from South Korea, for that matter, immensely great.
Yeah.
17,000 or 20,000 or so. But at the same time, in India, that was nearly 2,000. Such a big country with a huge population. So forget about America, European countries, but countries like Vietnam, South Korea, doing fairly well when it comes to patents. So I think our research community need to be given more awareness about the potential and the dynamics of how to go about it. So I think this session has done that job to the smaller community. I think this message can be spread by the participants further. On behalf of St. Thomas College, I extend sincere thanks to Dr. Manju Jerar for your wonderful exposition. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity given.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Father. I place my gratitude to Dr. Manju Jerar for the wonderful session. Thank you, ma'am. Hope audience fill the feedback form provided in the chat box. Tomorrow at 3 o'clock, we will have another great session with Ms. Angayar Kanni Ramaya on IPR in the precinct of competition law, when a refusal to deal should be exempted in high technology markets. See you all tomorrow. Until then, it's Nidhu Krishna signing off. Thank you.
Thank you.